Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Om salutations to the masters. Namaste and a very warm welcome to all our participants from across the globe. It has been an extremely enriching week thus far, 6 days of the Global Festival of Yoga. We are on the second session now, and this session is going to be a session by Srimati Shantala Sri Ramaya Ji. The session is like a follow-up on several sessions that have been building towards this particular evening. On 24th, we had a session by Srimati Nitya Jagannathanji on Yoga Kshema towards sustained wellness using mantra and bhavana. This morning, we had another one by Subha Vaidyanathanji on Ishwara Pranidhana, when surrender is victory. So we're moving towards this opening of the heart and opening of the being to receive the sounds that will heal us. Since the theme of this global festival this year is on healing, well-being, and wisdom. So it's a great pleasure to invite Srimati Shantala Sri Ramaya Ji today on the session. And the session is going to be on Mahamrityunjaya, the great death-conquering mantra. There are several stories about how powerful this mantra is and how it has healed and cured so many people across ages from different cultures as well. A little bit about Shantala Ji. Shantala Ji is an engineer by training, and she has applied her expertise to the engineering of the human vibratory structures as one of the most authentic teachers of mantra chanting in today's world. She was very fortunate to have grown up studying Sanskrit chanting and Indian scriptures from an early age as part of her family tradition and school education in Bangalore in India. She has also had the privilege of being mentored by several Vedic scholars, including the world-renowned Chellakere brothers. Based out of Belgium, she offers several courses to a growing global community of students through her online platform, vedabelgium.com. Shantala Ji is especially keen on connecting aspirants to the relevance of Vedas for personal development and to the source texts of the yogas, of yoga. And I have had the extreme good fortune and privilege of being her student myself. And I can vouch for the clarity and power with which she is able to communicate the precision of the articulation of Vedic mantras. She has herself experienced the benefit of these chants through her own personal journey of healing. So I invite Srimati Shantala Ramaya Ji to please come on screen and to lead this session on the Mahamrityunjaya mantra. The chat box will be open for anybody who would like to share their thoughts and comments, but do follow along. And if you have any questions, we will take them up at the end of the session as we normally do. So Shantala Ji, over to you. Thank you very much. And we really look forward to being nurtured through your session this evening. Thank you.
Hari Om and Namaste to everyone. And Anuji, thank you as always for the very warm and wonderful welcome you give me. You know, it's a bit of quite the love story with Indica Yoga for me. So lots of gratitude. Thank you so very much. I'd like to start with my invocation mantras. And then I'll jump into the topic for today because we have 1 hour. So I'd like to go straight into what we'd like to and spend some time on practice as well. So let me start with my invocation mantras that we recite in our Veda Vidyalaya.
Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. हरि ओम गणानांत्वा गणपतिगं हवामहे कविं कवीनामुपमश्रवस्तमं ज्येष्ठराजं ब्रह्मणां ब्रह्मणस्पत आनश्रुण्वन् नूतिभिः सीदसादनम् महागणपतये नमः प्रणो देवी सरस्वती वाजेभिर्वाजिनीवती धीनामवित्र्यवतु आनो दिवो बृहतः पर्वतादा सरस्वती यजता गन्तु यज्ञम् हवन् देवी जुजुषाणा घृताची शग्मान्नोवाचमुषति शृणोतु वाग्देव्यै नमः। ॐ सहनाववतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्तिश्शान्तिश्शान्तिः। So may we all be luminous and nourished in our study together. So today I will share with all of you a very powerful mantra for healing, the Mahamrityunjaya mantra, or literally translated as the death conquering mantra. But let's spend a little time actually understanding, you know, two sides of it. One is, you know, its significance, but also in terms of its pronunciation. So after the session, you will be able to hopefully be able to practice on your own as well through all the details that I will provide in terms of how to exactly pronounce it. And it's an often debated mantra with so many things in it. So I'll try to address some of those in my teaching, in my presentation today. And hopefully that will clear many questions, especially since it is such a popular mantra. And it seems that the more popular a mantra is, the more there are debates and questions about how it's pronounced, etc. And so while I don't claim to be someone who knows it perfectly or so, what I will do respectfully is to present it and offer it as it is taught to be by my gurus, the Challakere brothers. So that said, let me share my screen here. So because we use a lot of Sanskrit terminology, so I'd like for you to be able to see the sort of text. And when we do the chanting, of course, the text will be useful to follow along. But eventually the goal is when we do a japa that the mantra is memorized. But of course, until you perfect the swaras and the pronunciation, do use the text. So the Mahamrityunjaya mantra, or the death conquering mantra. Let me recite this mantra first so you can hear the words and hear the pronunciation a little bit. And then we'll go into a little more detail after that. ॐ त्र्यम्बकै यजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकै यजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकै यजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् So I don't know if you were able to listen to how the word is Triambakam, but we chant Triambakai, and a few other things like Mamritat, you know, we chanted as Mamritat. There seems to be a softer ending. So the chanting is a little bit different than how the text looks. And so I'll help you with all of this. But let's look at some context first. The Mahamrityunjaya Mantra is presented in the Rig Veda. So this number there, 7.59.12, it means it's in the 7th mandala, 59th sukta, and 12th mantra. So if you need to find it in, you know, to refer to what's before it, what's after it, etc., that's where you need to look. We also recite it as part of the Rudra Prashnaha chanting. So at the end of the 11 anuvakas of the Rudra Prashnaha, we recite the Mahamrityunjaya mantra along with some other closing mantras. This mantra is cast in the famous Anushtubh meter, which means that there are these four sections of 8 syllables each, and it was revealed to Rishi Vasishtha. So this is, you know, what I would call in the technical specs. As an engineer, you know, I think of these as the technical specifications of this mantra. And by knowing this, we honor the Rishi to whom it was revealed to, and we make ourselves, you know, discerning students. We can go and look it up, and we can refer to its meaning in, from several sources once we know where it is located in the Veda. The literal translation is very dramatic. The literal translation says Maha, the great, Mrityu, death, Jaya, conquering mantra. So this mantra is, it seems to be about conquering the inevitable death. And that's not what it is speaking about. So it is not about escaping the inevitable death of the body, but it is about finding that which is eternal in us, and therefore attaining that true immortality, is realizing our own true nature. And therefore, this mantra is one of those moksha mantras, mantras for liberation. And the japa is the repetition of this mantra. It's really a wonderful practice. I love doing the Mahamrityunjaya japa, and it's especially personally for me a really wonderful evening practice. You get a very good night's sleep, but of course don't practice right before bedtime, but in the evening is a good time to practice the Mahamrityunjaya mantra. Any time is good, but evening is especially good, at least for me. So this mantra is practiced, the prayoga is, the its utility is to overcome, the root of it is to overcome a fear of death. And we might not seem to acknowledge our own fear of death. I mean, we all have this. Even the wisest of the wise have a natural fear of death. And this is healthy and normal because it allows us to live intelligently. So we don't, you know, hurl ourselves off a high-rise building and so on because we know what the consequences of that will be. So it's not that kind of overcoming a fear of death, but it is overcoming all of the manifestations of that fear, unhealthy manifestations of that fear. Manifestations like anxiety, fear of the unknown, fear of what will happen, all these imaginations of what if scenarios, you know, and we are so good at that, at imagining things that have not happened but might happen, and, you know, imagining losing something or imagining falling sick or imagining running out of money and all those type of things that bring us angst. And also recovering from illness, this is a very powerful mantra for recovering from illness. And my teachers say it very beautifully. They say it's for recovering from extremely bad, what seem like death-like experiences. And therefore, Mahamrityunjaya mantra. We are overcoming these daily little deaths, so to speak, or death-like experiences that we go through by reciting this mantra, because it allows us to tap into that which is eternal in us, that which is constant in us, giving us comfort, giving us that peace. So the significance, or loosely translated meaning of this mantra, is Triambakam. Let's worship. We worship the three-eyed Lord. This is a reference to Rudra, a reference to an aspect of Shiva. So we worship the three-eyed one, Sugandhim, the fragrant one, who nourishes our health, who makes our health, you know, who strengthens and grows, Vardhanam, our health, Pushti. And just like a watermelon, or a watermelon-like, you know, fruit or vegetable that grows on a creeper. So Urva Rukam Ivam. Urva Rukam is this fruit, this reference to this fruit that grows on a vine, Eva, just like that. When this fruit is ripe, it is very easily released from its stem, or the creeper it is growing on. Just like that, I'd like to be released from death, but not from this immortality that I seek, not from Amritam. So may I be freed from this cycle of life, you know, birth, life, and death, and may I be united with that which is eternal in me, with immortality, so that in this lifetime, not some, you know, promised heaven of an afterlife, but during this lifetime, I can engage with my current life in the most joyful, in the most joyful, fulfilling way, without these, you know, daily fears that I go through. This is the idea. So it's a very powerful prayer or a petition, let's say, to the divine, to say that, you know, that you're a divine gardener, and you know exactly when I'm ready to be released from this creeper, and please do so, and please let me be released from this death, but not from immortality. So this is the significance of the mantra. And let's quickly look at, don't be overwhelmed with everything that you see on the screen here, but for those who prefer to use Devanagari, the Sanskrit script is there. And for those who prefer the English transliteration, that's there. And this color-coded schematic is to help you navigate the Vedic phonetics, which are so specific. And so you don't miss anything. And I will explain each syllable if needed. And if you have any questions about this, you know, do drop them in the Q&A chat, and we'll see how much of that we can address. So what you see, the first thing to note is that Triambakam Yajamahe. Triambakam is ending with this Anuswara, we call it, the M with dot underneath, or in Devanagari, it's just a bindu. This is what we call an Anuswara. It's an Ayogavaha. It doesn't have, it relies on the sound after it for its sound. And in this case, and this is very specific to Veda, this is Vedic Sanskrit phonetic rules and optional in classical Sanskrit. So you might not have studied this as part of a classical Sanskrit training, but this is very strictly followed in Vedic chanting. So Triambakam becomes Triambakai Yajamahi, because ya is a semi-vowel. So for those of you who know Sanskrit, I'll give a little bit more and make it a little more interesting for you. But others don't need to freak out with this too much information. You can just follow the text there that is guiding you, saying Triambakai Yajamahi. So there are four semi-vowels, ya, ra, la, va. And with the exception of ra, when the anuswara is followed by ya, la, and va, it becomes a nasal ya, va, la. And in this case, it becomes Triambakai Yajamahi. So it's Triambakai Yajamahi. Everything in red is an aspirated sound, Mahaprana. So it's not Sugandhim, It's sugandhim, pushti, vardhanam, urvarukamiva, bandhanan, bandhanan, amrityor mukshiya. Ksha is a special sanyuktakshara, special conjunct sound in Sanskritam. And in Vedic Sanskrit, it is an aspirated sound. Because all Ushma Varanas, all sibilant sounds like sha, sha, sa, ha, when they become Sanyuktakshara, they become aspirated in Vedic. Mrityor Mukshiya Mamritat. So what are all the blue colors then? The blue colored syllables are Sanyuktaksharas or conjunct consonants. And conjunct consonants, there is, a very strict rule in Veda that the starting sound, what is a conjunct consonant? It's the combination of two or more consonant sounds. And in Veda, we double the starting sound of that conjunct. So in Triambakam, it's the sound. Triambakam, sugandhim, pushti, vardhanam, urvarukamiva, bandhanan. Mrityor mukshiya. So the starting sound is doubled, and this is called dvitva. In the way that the Chalakere brothers teach in their Veda Vidyalaya, this is extremely strict. We are not allowed to progress unless we are vattakshara, they say. Is every conjunct consonant is clearly indicated in your chanting. So this is something also to pay attention to if you would like to recite it in a very powerful way. If you start following these rules, your chanting practice will really evolve, and you will start to find these that the sounds are more powerful. The sounds seem to vibrate in a way that naturally leads you to want to meditate afterwards. So these are very beautiful, very precise, but very beautiful rules. But of course, I don't want students to go having to spend a lifetime learning these rules, and therefore this color-coded schematic to help you through. So you see the blue sounds, you double it. The red-colored sounds are aspirated. And the yellow is all of the anuswara sounds, how they change. And that leaves that little purple syllable there, which is also a sanyuktakshara. So it's also a conjunct consonant. What is special about this, and it's not blue, it's purple, is because this particular combination requires you to pay attention to the length of the pronunciation. Mrityor mukshiya, mrityor mukshiya. It's as if it's longer than long, a tiny bit. And then the gripping or the doubling is still happening. So purple, just pay attention that it's a long enough sound. That's it. So that said, that was the entire, some of my students are calling this a Vedic surgery, where we really understand every syllable. And I really encourage students to really know your practice and understand your practice deeply. And if you wish to do that, this is the way to study Vedic mantras. This is how the Chalakere brothers teach all their students. Every syllable, every sound combination can be explained and is chanted a very unique, special way, and everything can be understood. So that said, let us now pray for our own health, well-being, and for being able to overcome all kinds of minor anxieties, fears, and learn a tool to be able to connect with something higher than us, and to ask for this kind of help and collaboration, let's say, in our daily lives, so we can live joyfully. So I'll repeat each pada, three times. So you can listen once and you can recite twice after that. And after a few recitations like that, I will just recite the whole thing and you can chant with me over my voice. We'll do that 108 times. I invite you to practice with me and see how you feel at the end of this. It will be about a the practice will take about 15 to 20 minutes. Okay. We recite only one om, after which we will chant only the mantra. The japa can be done both ways. You can include om each time, or you can chant the om once and then just do the mantra. Both ways are taught to us. Om Trimbakaya Jamahe, Trimbakaya Jamahe, Trimbakaya Jamahe, Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam, Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam, Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam, Urvarukamiva Bandhanan, Urvarukamiva Bandhanan, Urvarukamiva Bandhanan, Mrityor Mukshiyamamrataat, Mrityor Mukshiyamamrataat, Mrityor Mukshiyamamrataat. Just a quick note for anyone who is completely new to Vedic chanting, please note that the little symbols that you see on top of the syllables. So if you see a little vertical line over, for example, you see the little vertical line here over the A, it means go up. Triambakam, Yajamahe, Yajamahe are all chanted on the same note. Sugandhim, Ga comes down. Pushti, Pu goes up. Shti comes down. Pushti, Vardhanam. So this is the swara of the mantra. So we have to follow this also strictly. This is the language, the Vedic language is with accents, with these accents, and we follow that precisely. So try to listen and follow that as well, very precisely. Triambakaya Jamahe Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam. Triambakaya Jamahe Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam. Triambakaya Jamahe Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam. Urvarukamiva Bandhanan Mrityor Mukshiyamamrataat. Urvarukamiva Bandhanan Mrityor Mukshiyamamrataat. Urvarukamiva Bandhanan Mrityor Mukshiyamamrataat. I'll repeat like this one more time. Triambakaya Jamahe Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam. Triambakaya Jamahe Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam. Triambakaya Jamahe Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam. Urvarukamiva Bandhanan Mrityor Mukshiyamamrataat. Urvarukamiva Bandhanan Mrityor Mukshiyamamrataat. Urvarukamiva Bandhanan Mrityor Mukshiyamamrataat. Repeat with me now over my voice. Om Triambakaya Jamahe Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam. Urvarukamiva Bandhanan Mrityor Mukshiyamamrataat. 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 त्र्यंबकं यजामहे सुगंधिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् 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 त्र्यंबकं यजामहे सुगंधिं पुष्टिवर्धनम्
उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम्
उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् ॐ त्र्यम्बकैयजामहे सुगन्धिं पुष्टिवर्धनम् उर्वारुकमिव बन्धनान् मृत्योर्मुक्षीयमामृतात् यो रुद्रो अग्नौ यो अप्सुय ओषधीषु यो रुद्रो विश्वा भुवना विवेश तस्मै रुद्राय नमो अस्तु तमुष्टु हि यस्विषु सुधन्वायो विश्वस्य क्षयति भेषजस्य यक्ष्वा महे सौ मनसाय रुद्रन्नमो ओभिर्देवमसुरन्दुवस्य अयं मे हस्तो भगवान् अयं मे भगवत्तरः अयं मे ए विश्वभे एष जोऽयं शिवाभिमर्शनः येते सहस्रमयुतं पाशा मृत्योमर्त्याय हन्तवे तान् यज्ञस्य मायया सर्वानवयजामहे मृत्यवे स्वाहा मृत्यवे स्वाहा ॐ नमो भगवते रुद्राय विष्णवे मृत्युर्मे पाहि प्राणानां ग्रन्थिरसि रुद्रो मा विशान्तकः तेनान्नेनाप्यायस्व सदा शिवो ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः Please continue to sit in silence. We'll just observe silence for about a minute.
Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Anuji, over, back to you.
Thank you very much for that, I think, very stilling session. In fact, I was doing a translation for Rudolf Milia for his Pranayama Summit. And he talked about the stilling of the breath as one of the achievements of Pranayama. When you're neither breathing in or out, and it just held. And that was the experience that I had when I chant the Mahamrityunjaya mantra for a long time. And it just feels as if the breath is suspended. No? And I guess it's the suspension of breath that allows us to prolong our lives a little more, where there's no burnout of the in-breath and the out-breath. So thank you very much. That was a very, very powerful session. Very beautifully led from the beginning with the explanations all the way to the conduction of it. Thank you very much. I'll first take some questions and then I will first, sure. You know, ask you certain that I have of my own. But I also think one of the terms that I avoided in the beginning of the session was the word death as such, because in the situation of the pandemic, I think that is the one presence that has loomed large over populations, over the world, in fact. And in that context, to have this offering by you is a real gift. So there are different comments, words of appreciation coming in also. I Seema Sharma Ji says, no words, ma'am. It was deep solitude feeling. Dr. Renuka Anvekar Ji is asking you, Namaste Shantala Ji. Deja vu sensation I felt. I was in your class, which concluded a few days, Saturdays ago. I have seen yoga teachers offering this mantra to pregnant ladies in their prenatal yoga classes. Is it advised?
So the one thing that also Guruji tells us, Guruji Srinivasan of the Chalakere brothers tells us, is to not start a Vedic chanting practice while you're pregnant. If you have not chanted before, it is not a practice to commence while pregnant, because we have these aspirated sounds, and especially Mahamrityunjaya mantra is, you know, I don't know how many of you felt it. There is a very powerful sensation in the body. And, you know, and it is not something you want, you know, you don't want these new type of experiences while pregnant. To err on the side of caution, this is what we are told. But if you're someone who has already been practicing it always, it is not a problem to continue. But it is not something I would introduce to pregnant women. That's the short answer. I hope that helps.
Another very important, I mean, this question also leads on to the bigger question of women and chanting. And maybe you would like to shed some light on that, being such a popular teacher of Vedic chanting. So your personal experience. And if I can also request you to share your personal journey of healing through sure. your practice of chanting.
Sure. Which one first? Okay, so I thought you were taking other questions. No, okay, so let me address this quickly, since it's related, you know, to women chanting, etc. So the thing is, you know, we are often in India, especially, you know, in the West, you know, I teach in you know, based out of Belgium. And so I don't get this question here at all. So I feel very shielded from it. But from the Indian context, you know, because I also do a lot of work for the Chalakere brothers, you know, in like social media related, etc. And so I see the comments and I see what is happening. They are one of the few Veda Vidyalayas. We have others. We also have the wonderful KYM institution and certain others who are initiating women and, you know, actively teaching women Vedic chanting. So in general, generally speaking,
this whole thing about women should not chant Veda, you know, is not something we follow. Guruji Srinivasan's daughter, wife, they're all teaching. And I have had, you know, two healthy babies, and I chanted vigorously through my pregnancy, but it's because I've had a chanting practice since I was a little child. And it's not something new for me. So my body, breath, you know, psychologically, I'm completely tuned to the chanting practice, and it worked for me. That said, you know, we do observe certain things as women. So we are, first of all, very, you know, we honor our cycle. So, you know, it's what we call in our Veda Vidyalaya, we call it a ladies' holiday. I think the Ashtanga community also does this, you know, a ladies' holiday. So the first 3 days of your cycle is not a time to practice because, you know, you have certain other processes in the body working, and we don't want to sort of create any conflict with the natural body processes, you know, because the chanting practice is such an uplifting practice. And, you know, our menstruation is going in the opposite direction. So we want to sort of honor that and, you know, pay attention to that. So every woman is different, and we need to pay attention to that. And if you have pre-existing conditions, if you have other things like, you know, maybe fertility treatments in progress or certain other issues related to that, then you should, you know, think about it, treat it like a yoga practice. What are the things you would not do? You know, if you were pregnant, that's how you would treat any practice, not just the Vedic chanting practice. You know, you approach it mindfully. And for the average person who has no pre-existing conditions, is healthy, and has a natural attraction to the chanting practice, by all means, we can chant the Veda. There is no, you know, nothing, you know, the way we are told in India, you know, that lightning will strike down, terrible things will happen to your families, and all this I find is very fear-mongering. And, you know, it's like how we were told that we cannot vote, you know, until recently. Now we are being told you cannot chant the Veda. So that's you know, too extreme. But I think, you know, approach it with caution, and not caution, mindfulness, you know, like be aware of your own body, mind, and what works for you and what doesn't work for you. A chanting practice should leave you invigorated. If you're feeling tired instead, then, you know, you need to pay attention to that and things like that. So I hope that is a brief answer to that decadent question, always asked question.
Yes. And just the other thing about your personal, would you like to just share about that? Because this program is really about healing as well. So how mantras can play a very significant role in promoting self-healing.
Yes. You know, I think that our bodies are absolutely magnificent. We have all of the resources, you know, to recover from illnesses. And we can supplement that further, you know, we can reinforce those processes through the practice of, through our chanting practice. And to very briefly, you know, share my own practice on about 4 years ago, on the morning of my 44th birthday, and now everybody knows my age, I suffered a brain hemorrhage. So a bleeding in the brain, it was spontaneous. There were no signs of it coming. And this is with someone who, you know, I have a strong asana practice. And I had quit my job, you know, a couple of years before that. I'd quit my job and I was chanting full time. And so I was doing my dream job. So it's not even like I was stressed. And I'm just trying to lay ground that it was not some pre-existing condition that led to this brain hemorrhage. It was just something I've had since birth, perhaps. And I this event happened, and I was very lucky in that I had this second chance. Lucky in that I didn't die, and I'm still here to, you know, perform my duties, take care of my children. But because I had that opportunity and I spent a lot of time in intensive care when this happened, I decided, you know, there's this sankalpa in me that I would be the best brain hemorrhage survivor ever. And so I used all the resources that I had. You know, I went, I had all kinds of yoga therapy. And I must add that I did all the therapy, you know, modern medicine interventions that are required. I did not ignore any of that. So I, you know, completed my hospital stay. I did all the tests that are needed and I continued to, and all of that, you know, but there were a lot of drugs in my body, you know, a lot of morphine taken, all kinds of things, 2 surgeries, so many things. So I did a lot of practices, gentle practices to first, you know, sort of clean my system. And the mantra practice was a very big part of that, which is, you know, so I was silently chanting the Ayur mantra. It's a very beautiful mantra for healing. But just, you know, when I remember doing this MRI, and it's a horrible, you know, sensation doing the MRI, you know, huge loud noises in your head and things. And I would do Om chanting while that was going on. So many things, you know, and I feel like it has sort of led me to, it was a turning point where I always had a mantra practice, but that same mantra practice became much, much more prayerful and trusting and sort of allowing something higher to help my healing. This, and I think I've eventually had a full recovery, and it's just I'm in full gratitude. You know, I didn't. A lot of people suffer from, you know, loss of many things. You know, loss of use of certain body parts or limbs, and loss of memory, and so many things. It took me 2 years to make a full recovery, and maybe even 3 years. I feel like I'm still sort of, you know, I still have good and bad days, but mostly good days, and this is wonderful. And for me, this connection to mantra has been the very, very big support, a very big, alambana in overcoming any type of, you know, sensations that I had. You come out of a brain hemorrhage with brain fog, you know, we call it. This is, you know, a total not able to think clearly, not able to remember things, vision, you know, all kinds of things, sensitivity to light, noise, all types of things, which I've overcome with the mantra practice. Guruji Srinivasan taught me the pranayama practice with Gayatri, and it has been so cleansing, you know. I feel sharper than before. I feel more energetic than before, and life seems to have full clarity for me. For me, I feel like, you know, everybody said I need to slow down, but the opposite has happened. Because it is after that that the Veda Studies platform was born, and then suddenly overnight it feels like there's all these courses online and an international student community. It's all after that. So, you know what, an event that should have been a slowing down of life for me was the greatest accelerator. And I owe everything to a consistent mantra practice, you know, and practicing daily. For me, not a day goes by without the practice, you know, without my daily practice. So that's the short.
Very much, Shanti Subbaraman.
Short summary.
Shanti Subbaramanji is saying that overwhelming. Thanks for sharing this personal life-changing experience.
Yes.
Thank you very much. And we also have another question here by Vaidyanathan Krishnamurthy. Firstly, he was very appreciative of your session. He says, thank you for Shantala ji. I've been chanting Mahamrityunjaya Japa, but not very regularly, but off and on. But never have I had and felt the vibrations like today. Very grateful. And he has a specific question. He says, I have a friend of mine has had a brain surgery, and I was chanting on her behalf. So does it have the same effect if we chant on behalf of the person or the loved ones who's unable to chant due to an illness? So how do you answer that?
You know, what my teachers tell us is that we should not underestimate the power of our prayer. And the prayer is always going to result in a response from the universe. I'm using the word universe, but, you know, Ishvara. Ishvara is this one object of meditation who reciprocates. We receive anugraha, we receive grace in return. And so if you are chanting, praying for a friend, it's definitely beneficial. Your friends, your family are lucky to have someone doing that for them. So absolutely, we must pray for ourselves, you know, chant for ourselves, but also for our communities.
I think more so again in today's context where there is
absolutely
so many people who are being hit. I have another question from Suresh Joshiji, who says that sometimes this mantra is chanted first with the Bija mantra and it ends with the Bija mantra, Bhum Jum Saha Bhur Bhuva Swaha. It increases the effectiveness of this mantra. Please explain on that a little. What's the role of the Bija mantras?
Okay, so, you know, I'm my practices are in the Vaidika tradition, Vaidika Sampradaya. So what we do is learning from Vedic scholars. What is the name of the participant asking this question?
Sureshji.
Yeah, so what Sureshji is talking about is, you know, Tantrika practice and through initiation. So it must, those Bija mantras must, must be learned from a guru who initiates you and explains those Bija mantras to you. And you must learn it from your guru. And so, and it is not my area of expertise. And so we do a Vaidika practice only. And this anyone can do. What I am offering, anyone can do. And you can just learn it and you can just practice it.
Thank you very much. You also answered a few other questions that were there on a similar lines of getting Diksha. Another question by Ashok Gutsurkar ji, who's saying that could understand recitation steps well. We'll also try to practice, but there are some inherent defects in my pronunciation. Is there any harm if I make mistakes when I have devotion in mind?
So again, you know, these are not my words. I will just keep referring back to what my teachers say because, you know, they are of more authority than me. But what my teachers say is that any, you know, these spiritual practices, this whole idea of harm, you know, it's not going to cause you harm, okay? But at the same time, equally, if you know there are defects, you know, what is the effort that you're investing in overcoming those defects? That effort, you will get a lot of benefits from. So what my teachers say is that, you know, have that aspiration, have that, you know, put some effort into learning the mantra that you practice. Keep that view in mind that I want to learn it correctly and don't lose that. Just to say that, you know, because I have a devotional, perspective, because I'm very devotional, nothing bad will happen to me. We don't want that complacence either. So continue to think and find ways to perfect yourself, whilst also knowing that your current practice will not cause you harm. That's the that's the words from my teacher.
Thank you. But at the same time, I think I would also, from a personal experience in a workshop, I know that the sounds are very powerful. So one has to be conscious, especially if one has certain abdominal problems and all, surgeries and all, especially one needs to be a little careful.
Yeah, this I've said, you know, that, you need yes. to.
If you, you have need any to, kind yes. of physiological illness or, you know, operation or something, then I think one needs to take a little bit of precaution. It's certain
Absolutely.
Sounds, yes.
Absolutely. And, you know, the other thing is that, especially if you're in a teaching position, if you're, you know, if you have the privilege of sharing with others, I think it is your duty to have learnt it correctly first. The swaras have to be correct because otherwise, you know, we become the reason why people are learning it incorrectly. We don't want that. So if you're a teacher, then, you know, put in the effort to make sure that somebody has signed you off to teach those mantras, that the swaras are correct, especially with this mantra. I hear often people are chanting it like Triambakai Yajamahe, a very sing-songy way. And this is, you know, passed on and on and on, and but the swaras are so different as presented in the Veda. So some effort, some investment in learning and practicing yourself the right swaras, the right Vedic phonetics, and then passing it on is a huge service to our tradition and our, you know, sampradaya in preserving it. And also that you can hear the vibration, you can hear the sensation you're left with is entirely different when you follow it in this way. And so why wouldn't you want others to experience that beauty and that power, right? So with that in mind, I think as especially teachers should only be teaching after they have learned it from another initiated teacher. This is, I had to get that in.
No, I think it's important to get the correctness, to experience the full power in its original, the way it was received. So if there is that precision, it will have that same effect. Because as I say, mantra is nothing but systematized sound technology. You key in the right passwords and those dimensions of the universe open up. Yeah.
Exactly. You know, I mean, you're speaking my language now, you know, I feel like, I mean, indeed, you know, people, the other day I was doing an interview and my host was asking me, you know, you've made this huge shift in life, you know, from your technology career. You know, I was running HR for and technology for, you know, HR technology, basically for so many technology companies. And then I started teaching chanting. And I said, no, there has been no career change. It's just a continuation. I'm doing exactly the same job. You know, I used to roll out e-learning systems and all those, you know, online learning platforms and things for organizations. I'm just doing it now for Veda. And this is the same job I have. And it's really a technology. And the entire idea of prayer, you know, for an engineer was very difficult to come to terms with. Because I used to say, you need to, you know, it's like asking for something. But, you know, when I started to look at it as a technology, it started to become something very intelligent, very clever to do, you know, to ask for help, to ask to reinforce. There are so many unknown variables in our life, you know, that we don't know about. What can we do to try to make all those unknown variables work in your favor? Prayer, mantra. It's such a smart thing to do. And so it has been a complete shift for me in terms of now is the whole, you know, the entire day spent prayerfully because of mantra being such a big part of my life.
Wonderful. There is one technical, as in an engineering question from a friend, good friend Dylan, who's saying that, how did it feel to chant in the MRI chamber? Anything happened when the magnetic and the sound field merged?
So, the main thing is that I was able to tolerate it. For me, that was the biggest gain, you know, because it was, you know, so physically, I was so depleted, you know, in those days in hospital. And I went through at least two MRIs and two, you know, these non-invasive type surgeries or whatever. So it helped me sort of endure it. It gave me something to focus on. And it gave me something positive and beautiful to focus on. And so it's, you know, so I don't have any miraculous experiences, but I think these small things are so much more powerful and important. So there were no violins playing. And so very sorry to disappoint. But I was able to tolerate it, and it didn't feel like, you know, it didn't feel like people were hammering my head. So that was.
Thank you for sharing that. We have a student of yours, Karen Keynes, who's saying she's such a wonderful teacher. I'm very grateful. She's so well and makes this chanting accessible to for people like me. I totally agree with that. We have, the questions, the reigning questions. So I will have to make a selection, and I ask to be excused for that in the interest of time. But a very practical question by Sunil Kumar ji and also by Alka Rangnekar ji, I'll combine the two, says that, is there a prescribed time, place for chanting this, or only in a quiet environment, or is only a quiet environment required? And the other one, is there a routine that is recommended, a number of repetitions? And sorry, there was another one here, which is again related, because it said that do we have to be, you know, sitting in one place? Can we roam around? Can we walk in nature and also say this mantra?
See, normally when we are talking about, so I'll answer this. Normally, what our texts say also is that if you want to have a single point of focus, if you want to focus only on one object while meditating, then you need a seated practice for that. So, you know, if you want your daily practice, try to find a place where you can sit and practice. This is especially for a beginner. If you're starting off, it's very useful because these are subtle practices, and in the environment that is quiet, where you're seated, where there is no other movement, you're able to maybe recognize, you know, the effects of the chanting for yourself. That would be the ideal scenario. That said, if you enjoy the idea of chanting while walking in nature, etc., you know, please, you know, feel free to do so. It's very enjoyable. I do it also, but I do have a daily seated practice. I find it very important to bring everything else to rest, let's say, to bring everything to one point of focus. And this is possible only in a seated practice. You know, if you were doing a pranayama practice, you cannot do it walking around. So chanting is like pranayama. So a seated practice is recommended. While if you are learning the mantra and you want to practice it, then you can walk around and, you know, the learning can happen that way. But an actual japa practice is a seated practice, and you need to give it that time if possible. And is there any particular like sequence, etc.? So you can build your own sequence, but my personal practice starts with invocation mantras. So Sri Guru Bhyo Namaha, Harihi Om, followed by Ganapati Prarthana, followed by Saraswati Prarthana. And then I do my japa, and then I do my closing. So you can do something like that. It's very easy to do. You can just start with a Sri Guru Bhyo Namaha, do your pranayama practice if you have one, and then do your japa practice. And the japa, when you start in the beginning, until you have memorized the mantra, do a loud practice. And once you have memorized it, try to move to a silent practice. It's very challenging because you know, a silent practice basically demands even more stillness, even more focus. It's very tough. So try it and see eventually, you know. It's nice to have these type of goals for any meditation, any meditative, any subtle practice. So you can give the mind your something to do. But as a beginner, it's very, very important to have a properly loud practice, because you're offering, you're using your whole body, the apparatus, you know, the whole mind, body, voice, sound apparatus, to, you're offering it to the divine. It's a type of yajna. It's a type of offering. And this is very important in the beginning. And you learn the right sounds, and you're, you know, it's magnificent. I still do a loud japa practice and I really enjoy it. I do it because I really enjoy it. It should be enjoyable. You should enjoy it. And when japa ends, you should feel like, oh my God, it's already ended, you know, and I want to do it again. When I chant the Lalita Sahasranama, you know, I'm very sad when it ends. Then I want to do something else. It should feel like that. Then you're on the right track. The sounds, you know. Yeah, good.
And, thank you. Yes, I think I will have to stop here, though there are many questions and many words of appreciation coming in for you. But we'll make the announcements for the next session, and then we'll come back to you to let our participants know how they can follow your work, because you have so many wonderful courses online. So I'm sure people, there were also questions about, you know, how to read the way you have presented it, you know, so the color code, etc., you know. So I think if they follow your courses online, they will get a good flavor of that. And you offer those free chanting sessions also. So if you'd like to tell them a little bit about them and your message. So I'd like to invite Vinay Chandraji, if he's here, to please come and make the announcements for tomorrow's program.
Namaste. Can I request Koti ji to present us the events for tomorrow? And while he does that, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank Shantala ji for being with us, for having this continued journey with Indica Yoga. We had her session last year, wonderful session. We have not still forgotten the effects of that session, and already we have the second year. And in between, we also had a special scholarship program which Shantala ji led, and we have about 11 participants who participated and benefited greatly from her teaching. And we look forward to such continued engagements with Shantala ji. But there is one thing that I think what I hear from the message that she is bringing to all of us is this, that Vedic teaching, Vedic learning is such an intangible heritage of all humanity. So each one of us should make attempt to the extent possible to pick up something, to learn something. And especially for Indians, it could be available in their own cultural context, but for others also, today the world has opened up. There are teachers like Shantala ji who are available and who are willing and so generous in sharing their knowledge and their expertise. So this is definitely one of the best times for humanity to learn something, and especially learn the science of chanting, the Vedic chanting. So this is the subtle message, because this is such a great heritage that we are all gifted with. And if we are not able to open up the treasure box and make use of it, we are missing out something that is so valuable. So thank you, Shantala ji, too, for reminding us once again of the treasure that we carry within ourselves. Thank you. And regarding tomorrow's announcements, as we await for the poster to come in, maybe I'll quickly take you through the events. Tomorrow morning, we have a very special event, that is Suryathon Finale. We ran a movement called Suryathon or Surya Namaskar Marathon, which was launched on 29th of last month. It started from 1st June and ran up to 28th June. So we were supposed to conclude it at 28th June, but the response was so overwhelming that we continued, and tomorrow we are concluding it. This was organized in association of several other organizations, including our own Center for Soft Power, Enigma, that is the Association of Yoga and Naturopathy Doctors, then ICCR, that's the government cultural wing, and also our digital partner, Lifecycle. So they provided us with an app through which participants could connect and record their Surya Namaskars. And I don't want to reveal it at this point of now. We have some amazing responses, and we will be sharing all those data tomorrow morning, and you will be overwhelmed with what you will see or what you will hear. And what was the best thing of this entire project was that we had a charity partner, Youth for Seva, because each Surya Namaskar that was done, we were able to raise 10 rupees for COVID relief care, and especially for children who have lost their parents. So anyone who did one Surya Namaskar, it not only benefited them, but also it will be benefiting the future of a child somewhere. So this was the kind of work that was done. And tomorrow will be a grand finale for the Suryathon. And I invite you all to join us for this. And again, tomorrow evening, we have another beautiful event called as Raga and Yoga, where we have a couple, Srimati Bhavana and Pradyumna, who will be joining us from Paris. They have their own platform called Karnataka, Carnatic Conservatory Paris, where they have tried to put together or explore the insights and teachings of yoga tradition through the Carnatic music tradition. How the yogic ideas express themselves through Carnatic music tradition, especially through the work of various kirtans. So this is the session tomorrow. And for this session, we have many dignitaries joining us. We'll be joined by Indian Embassy France. We also have Kiran Vyasji, who is one of the foremost Ayurveda practitioner in France. And we'll also be joined by a great musician, Anur Krishna Sharma. So these dignitaries, stellar personalities, will be lighting up our session. And Pradyumna ji and Bhavna ji will be providing an enchanting music through Raga and Yoga program. So I invite you all to participate in both these events, and have a wonderful Sunday with us tomorrow. So with this, over to Anuradha.
Shantala ji. Yes, so back to you. So please let our participants know how they can connect to your work so that they can all be benefited. Vinay ji has given everybody a task that it's now our daitwa, it's our responsibility to, you know, to partake of this heritage and experience its benefits for oneself. So please.
So the best way to reach me is to go to my website. So this is vedastudies.com. Veda Belgium is okay, but I think this Veda Studies is better for those who are, you know, located everywhere, not just in Belgium. And you'll be able to sign up for my free course on the website. So there's almost 6 hours of instruction to get to learn the basics of Vedic chanting. And you will be able to learn the Gayatri Mantra with all the Vedic phonetics and a full detail, and also do a 108 times japa with me through the platform at your own time, in your own place, you know, so you can plan according to your schedule how to do it. And I know that many people continue to use that 108 times practice on a daily basis. So first step is to make sure you cultivate some kind of a daily habit of chanting. So that's the first step. So once you sign up to this Veda Studies course, the free course, you automatically get on my newsletter. And this is my primary mode of communication is, you know, it's not on WhatsApp or I don't announce so much on everywhere else, but my newsletters every week you will get. And I offer lots of free community events. Almost every Friday, there is some kind of chanting on Zoom, and between 100 to 200 people participate each week, and they will always remain free. And I always tell people, don't sign up for a long course with me until you've done a few of these and sort of know my style of teaching and, you know, how intense it can be. And then there are, you know, other, I run a Suktam course every Tuesday. It's always running. And sometimes I do workshops on weekends. And there is a one-year course on Rudram that is running right now. We are 5 months into the course. We always start every year on Shivaratri. So the next course will start in March. And it's a one-year course. But to qualify for that, you need to be able to know all the rules of chanting, know some suktams, have a daily practice, because it's intensive on the breath, etc. So if you're a beginner, don't write to me with, how can I learn Rudram? You must first learn, have a two-year practice before aspiring to learn Rudram. This is the general initially you need to give 18 months to 2 years to become an established student, regular student of Veda. And then you can learn suktams, and, you know, it's really a lifetime of a very beautiful addiction. You can keep learning so many different ways to connect with the divine. So this is the best way to reach me and learn. And what was the other question, Anuji? Was this the only one?
Yes, basically this, and then we jump to your message. But before you give your message, there was just one thought that struck me as I was listening to your to the translation you gave of the Mahamrityunjaya Mantra. And I thought it would be worth sharing here. And it was this, that you, when you compared the watermelon, you know, you said Urvarukam is a watermelon, or sometimes it's referred to as the cucumber. Okay.
Yes.
But what was interesting is the fact that while it is raw, this relationship with death is difficult to break. It's a certain ripeness of
maturity.
Yes, a certain maturity and a ripeness of consciousness by which death falls off and we experience our inherent immortality. So I think that was my personal takeaway in terms of just our relationship with death, basically. The more immature, the more we are bound by the ideas of death in everything. So like you said, it's not just about the death, but the whole concept of abhinivesha, you know, this feeling that you're dying because something changed, and, you know, So
we use it in our language, right? We use it in our daily language also, you know, oh, I'm going to die if this happens. I mean, we use it so casually sometimes. you know, but it shows exactly that. Yeah, very beautifully summarized for me. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So I'd like to also invite you to give your message to the participants before we close.
You know, I'm going to totally steal Vinayaji's message, which is that, I mean, we have such an amazing, treasure house. We are sitting on a treasure of ancient, beautiful, inspiring, relevant practices. You know, there's none of our yogic, Vedic, tantric practices have become, obsolete, unlike new technology, which keeps becoming obsolete. Our oldest technology of the rishis continues to serve people. And we should take, advantage of that. And we should learn in a respectful, deep way. You know, it's not just like learning this and then learning that and learning to another one. You know, study with a teacher, give that teacher some time, and develop your own daily practice. There is no shortcut. You know, we have to invest in a daily practice. This is my message to people, is cultivate this daily subtle practice of something. You know, it doesn't have to be mantra, it can be pranayama, it can be something. Have a daily consistent practice. Show yourself that you can do, have a practice every day and see where it takes you. And this is my message, because that is when we start to become self-reliant. We start to rely upon ourselves versus our situation and versus our, anything around us for this sense of this anchoring. We become our own anchor. Our practice itself becomes our own anchor. This is my message, is to develop a practice.
Thank you very much. I think with these words, we can end the session. Om Shanti, and thank you again very much. Look forward to staying in touch and having you back again.
Dhanyavad to all the participants
for being there with full enthusiasm. Thank you.